Skeletons, it is Disney Queen Skelly here, and welcome back to another scary Disney story. So today's Disney story is Discovering Disney's Lost Discovery Island Amusement Park. Here's another person's strange story of finding Disney's old River Country Park, and it is just eerie. So, as you guys know, I have already done a story on Disney's River Country, though this one actually takes place on Discovery Island, not River Country. So, I hope you guys enjoy this spooky story. Here we go. Discovering Disney's Lost Discovery Island Amusement Park. Here's another person's story of finding Disney's old River Country Park, and it is eerie. After our first and admittedly quick visit to River Country one day before going drinking in downtown Disney, we decided that we wanted to swim the short distance between the park and Discovery Island. For those of you who don't know, Discovery Island was essentially a precursor to Animal Kingdom, functioning as a small zoo with a various assortment of animals. When River Country shut down and Animal Kingdom opened around the same time, the animals from Discovery Island were moved to the theme park. A section of Animal Kingdom is still called Discovery Island to pay homage to the now abandoned island. Anyway, Joe and I started planning that day as to how to get over to the island. As I'm sure you've also heard, Disney has eyes everywhere. There are cameras and security guards everywhere you look, and thankfully you can learn to spot them and their hiding places. Joe and I hunched over our liquor in the most crowded parts of the bars of Pleasure Island as we talked in hushed voices about how and what we were going to do to get over to Discovery Island. Looking back, I'm thankful we weren't caught and banned for life based on the conversation we had that night. The two of us would set out shortly after dusk. The time I broke into Disney. I recently read somebody's thread on here about breaking into River Country at Disney. I've also done it, but I took the next step as well, swimming to Discovery Island and spending a night there. I was a senior in college finishing up my photography major when I began to hear hushed murmurs from my cohort about urbex urban exploring. For those of you who don't know, urbex is when people illegally break into abandoned locations to go exploring, usually just for the hell of it. It became increasingly popular with photographers, however, because many of the occupants and businesses in those decrepit buildings just up and leave, leaving all sorts of records and items behind. It's like a living snapshot from decades, if not centuries ago. As soon as you make your first cautious steps into the building, it takes hold of you and transports you to the past. I gained enough confidence to go urbexing with a few friends, and it didn't take long for me to fall in love. I visited abandoned funeral homes that were shut down a century ago, where I marveled at how the place still smelled of the embalming fluid still stored in there, safe in their glass jars. Aside from the layers of dust and debris, it looked and felt as if a funeral service would be held within the hour in the sanctuary. There was even an open casket near the pastor's podium, sitting there with its polished oak and fine velvet interior, still waiting to take someone to their final journey. I explored abandoned hospitals and mental institutions. There have been shows that try to illustrate what the inside of these look like. They hardly compare to being there yourself. Each time you enter one of these abandoned buildings, it is like you're in the gold room of The Shining, and you seem to be locked in a time warp for the duration of your stay. For instance, when I explored S Mental Hospital in the middle of my stay, I continually expected a neurotic psych patient to come shuffling around every corner, which had me sweating bullets and kept me on edge all night. Places in despair and suffering are especially prone to the collection of energy. I am absolutely certain that there are patients within that building that still reside there, even though their bodily forms have long since decayed. But enough about that. Every urbexer in my home state of Florida knows about River Country. Located within Fort Wilderness Campground on Walt Disney World property, it's actually really easy to break into if you know what you're doing and where you need to go. Don't ask me how to get in, I won't tell you. It's a thing for people of all ages to do, whether to experience the nostalgia of visiting the water park when it was open. I, for one, have pictures of me on the slides of River Country and the shows and the exhibits of Discovery Island when they were both in business. Or because they were so obsessed with Disney that visiting the decrepit water park has become a rite of passage. The brave souls who visit the abandoned water park know that if they get caught, they are permanently banned from Walt Disney World for life. But for some like me and my friend Joe, the cheap thrill of exploration outweighed the consequences of being banned from the biggest tourist trap in the eastern U.S. After our first and admittedly quick visit to River Country one day before going drinking in downtown Disney, We decided that we wanted to swim the short distance between the park and Discovery Island. And for those of you who don't know, Discovery Island was essentially a precursor to Animal Kingdom, functioning as a small zoo with a various assortment of animals. When River Country shut down and Animal Kingdom opened around the same time, the animals from Discovery Island were moved from the theme park. A section of Animal Kingdom is still called Discovery Island to pay homage to the now abandoned island. Anyway, Joe and I started planning that day as to how to get over to the island. As I'm sure you also heard, Disney has eyes everywhere. There are cameras and security guards everywhere you look, and thankfully you can learn to spot them and their hiding places. Joe and I hunched over our liquor in the most crowded parts of the bars of Pleasure Island as we talked in hushed voices about how and what we were going to do to get over to Discovery Island. Looking back, I'm thankful we weren't caught and banned for life based on the conversation we had that night. When Joe and I went back to our hotel room after drinking, I quickly pulled out the laptop to do some research on the area around River Country, Discovery Island, and Bay Lake, which is the lake that the island sits in. The first thing I noticed is how much stuff there is online with regards to boat schedules and where security will be throughout Walt Disney World at any point in time. Joe and I use these articles and forums posts to know when to avoid being around the island's shores. It's basically all day, if you were wondering. We also used aerial maps to extrapolate how long we had to swim. While many Disney forums said that it would be a grueling 100-foot swim, Joe and I realized that it would be a 100-yard swim in calm water after visiting Fort Wilderness and River Country for ourselves. Thankfully, Joe and I were both strong swimmers, so the excursion wouldn't be a problem for us. The two of us would set out shortly after dusk. We packed essentials like water, food, and some survival gear just in case into a couple waterproof bags that would act as our personal floating devices as we swim from River Country to Discovery Island. Then we left our car at the hotel and took one of the complimentary Disney shuttles to Fort Wilderness, where we spent the day acting like tourists, sitting on the beaches, playing in the pool, and visiting the animals at the campground's petting zoo. When dusk came and security guards went home for the night, Joe and I made our way back into River Country, which was to be our launch point to the island, and our returning point to when we came back. We operated in the pitch darkness, making as little noise as possible, as we found the hole in the fence that let us go into the abandoned water park. As with almost every other abandoned location I visited, River Country looked frozen in time, with its inner tubes, water slides, offices, and pathways still intact. Joe and I took some time to explore the empty pools and water slides of the park before making our way to our launch point. The silence of the night was broken when we started hearing banjo music playing from everywhere, which made me jump a mile. I've probably watched Deliver once too many times. Soon after the corny little banjo time came on, path lights began to illuminate a safe route to our launch point. Apparently, Disney is too cheap to stop running electricity and music to their abandoned properties. The swim to Discovery Island was about as easy as I expected it to be, and that calm winter night. There were pages and pages of forums that warned of the alligators and brain-eating amoebas that polluted Bay Lake, but I didn't heed their advice. Every native Floridian grows up swimming with alligators and diving in natural waterways with God knows what microbes, so swimming in Bay Lake would be no different. Joe and I made it to Discovery Island after about 30 minutes of slow swimming. We threw the waterproof bags on our backs and began our trek into the island where it would be harder to spot us. Within our first few minutes on the island, Joe and I got this feeling of being watched, like we were being stalked by some larger predator. He chalked it up to adrenaline and called me a pussy as we found the path to follow. My childhood memories of Discovery Island are ones that I will always cherish. I got to spend a week camping with my family at Fort Wilderness, and we would often take the ferry over to the island to visit the tropical birds and see the collections of exotic animals. It was like a scene straight out of the Jungle Book, with its sculpted plants and the din of the exotic animals rustling and calling out from the luscious trees above. The quaint little island that still holds this charm, although the exotic plants have overgrown and taken over the island, giving it a more wild experience. The path we chose led up to a series of cages and small fences. It was obvious that during its glory days, this area housed a number of exotic birds that were free to roam around as they pleased. The cages were probably used to house small animals or large birds of some sort. Nothing had the shallow ponds and sculpted waterfalls still retained their beauty. We then went to inspect the cages, which still had their exhibit signs on them. There was a large array of South American and African birds that once lived there, with the occasional mammal, but now all the cages were empty. I was inspecting a cage that once housed toucans when I heard something shuffling nearby. "Jojo, what was that?" I asked, looking around to spot the danger. Joe pulled a knife from his pocket and brandished it in the direction of the noise. He threatened to knife whatever came out of the bushes until he saw what it was. A tortoise. A giant fucking tortoise. Like one of the ones from the Galapagos. "Look, he must be a stowaway," I explained, walking over to squat down in front of the large reptile. It hissed at me and raised its head in defense, as we were probably the first humans he had seen. I bet his parents had laid eggs that the staff didn't know about. There are probably a few of these guys scooting around the island, I bet. There's certainly enough vegetation for them to eat. I patted the tortoise's shell as Joe made his way over to do the same. "See, the island's not so bad, huh?" he asked as he pet our new friend. His toothy grin reeked of the confidence and fearlessness that I lacked. Joe and I spent a few more moments with the tortoise before we moved on to explore more of the island. We found more exhibits and paths that led around this way and that. We couldn't help but take our time to explore each exhibit area and read every sign, spending on an eventful night nestled in the thick foliage of Discovery Island. Daytime was different, though. We had agreed to wait until dawn to start exploring the buildings that were still on the property, the majority of which we had found during our nighttime scouting. First was the gift shop, located just inside the main dock where the ferry used to pull in. The cheery images of Mickey, Minnie, Goofy, and Donald in safari gear still looked new, even if the colors were slightly faded. There was still merchandise on the shelves as well, and Joe managed to stuff a commemorative magnet into his pocket while I looked at all the stuffed animals and t-shirts. I, for one, wasn't keen on stealing. Once we were finished checking out the gift shops, we went to go exploring the husbandry buildings and indoor animal houses. Those buildings were still all pitch black, save for the small areas of light that shone through the windows. Looking much like Mulder and Scully, as we found the center of a large exhibit hall, Joe and I pulled out our flashlights and quickly realized that we weren't alone. Eyes. There were dozens of pairs of eyes reflecting the light back at us. Joe and I froze in our tracks as we saw a colony of monkeys looking back at us. They were larger and far more muscular than any monkey I've ever seen before, probably a cross between multiple species that used to be on display. One of them yawned and showed off its fangs that were easily the size of my middle finger. We knew we had to leave now. "More leftovers," Joe murmured to me as we began shuffling backwards the door. We didn't lose focus on the group of primates who were beginning to congregate. My friend's heel caught on something as we moved and he fell backward, hitting his head on the old concrete below with a loud smack, where he became unconscious. The colony of monkeys noticed Joe's fall as well. Acting like one large animal, they all band together and moved in sync towards the still body of my friend, whooping and hollering at the tops of their lungs. Their screams sounded humor-like as they approached, some of them standing on two legs as they did so. The larger monkeys had to be at least 4 feet tall on their hind legs, looking almost human-like with their patches of shaggy brown hair on their heads and coarse short hair on their bodies. With what 20 of them now approaching, Joe and I, with a predatory stare, I knew that I was going to be no match fighting them off. I slowly backed up 25 yards or so away from my unconscious friend before the colony of monkeys made their descent. What happened then is something I'll never forget. The monkeys, who now surrounded my friend, began to eat him alive. Joe's screams of anguish were deafened by the screams of the monkeys, who were now excited and enraged. They took large bloody bites out of my friend, ripping him apart like a child's doll. Joe had a slow death, slower than I could have imagined from being ripped open, but I can only assume he was in a state of shock as the monkeys began to violently tear his intestines and other organs out of his body cavity and drag them off into their own corners of the room to eat. Occasionally, two monkeys would squabble over a clearly distinguishable body part, and I would often hear the loud crack of bones being broken from their strong rows of large teeth. I waited until each last monkey was occupied with eating before I made my escape out of that building and to the edge of the island. Thankfully, none of them pursued me as I made my leave, beelining it to the opposite side of the island. My best friend was gone. It was his idea to go to the stupid island. He called me a pussy for being so afraid. I guess I was right after all to have my wits about me, because he was now in a dozen pieces being ravenously devoured by some strange mutant primates that Disney doesn't want their guests to know about. I bet there are more animals on that island, ones that have evolved and mutated to become monstrous and aggressive beyond belief. I didn't stick around to find out. I can tell you that for sure. Being banned by some stupid park was far safer than being stuck on an island with God knows what wants to eat me now. I don't even remember the swim back to River Country except for the fact that I made it back to the main Fort Wilderness campground safe and sound and without getting caught. Upon returning home and taking a week of personal time to recover, I went to a local Urbex meetup to tell people what had happened to my friend Joe. I was expecting surprise reactions from all the Urbexers, but instead I was met with understanding and sympathy. Apparently many people go out to Discovery Island. It's a thing, just like breaking into River Country is. However, most people don't make it back from the island alive, and the ones that do share their stories of predatory animals of all shapes and sizes. Some who survived their visit to Discovery Island say that Disney has a child trafficking ring, and the children who don't survive are brought to the island so no evidence can be found. Others say that black magic and human sacrifices are performed there to keep Disney's profits up. Walt Disney himself knew a lot about occultism, as the stories go. It doesn't matter to me which rumor about Discovery Island you believe or why you would even want to go urbexing on Disney property. If you are wise, you'll heed my advice and never swim out to that goddamn island. If you do, prepare yourself for the horrors that abound in the one place that lifts the innocent veil of the happiest place on earth.
Alright guys, and that is it for today's scary story. Let me know what you think about it in the comment section down below. I will admit this is one of the more tamer stories I have actually done, but nonetheless, these are all still pretty freaky, so I thank y'all so much for watching, and I'll see you tomorrow. Bye little skeletons. Stay safe. I love you guys.